discuss about the assumptions that are actually taken for an ideal MOS capacitor. Okay, and to proceed before proceeding further, actually, I would like to give you two concepts regarding the MOS capacitor with the help of this picture. Okay, so let me draw the MOS capacitor picture first. So the metal region, oxide, and the semiconductor. Okay, and then let us say potential is applied here, which is capital V, and this terminal is grounded. Okay, let us say that the thickness of this region is D, the thickness of this oxide is D. Okay, and let us say shear, the potential drop across this oxide region is VO. The potential drop across this oxide is VO, and the potential drop in the semiconductor is psi s. So let us say that this is a neutral semiconductor. Here we are considering the semiconductor to be p-type. Okay, so this is p-type semiconductor, and this region remains neutral. Okay, because the thickness of this semiconductor is quite large, so this region neutral semiconductor. However, the status of this region may change. Okay, so let us say that the potential here at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. So why I will call it silicon dioxide? Because if I take semiconductor as a silicon, then the natural insulator is silicon dioxide. So when I call it silicon-silicon dioxide interface, I will be actually talking about this line. Okay, so the potential here at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface with respect to this neutral silicon region is let us say equal to psi s, which is noted as the surface potential. Okay, this is psi s, and the potential drop in the oxide is V naught. Okay, so the external potential that is applied here is V. So under if we are considering the ideal MOS capacitor, then this V is going to be equal to V naught plus psi s. Okay, so part of this V will drop in this oxide region, and the part of V will actually drop in the semiconductor psi s. Okay, so V, the gate voltage is equal to V naught plus psi s. Okay, and similarly there could be charge in the metal region. So let us say this is equal to QG, because this terminal is gate terminal, so I am using subscript G. So QG is the gate charge. Okay, it's a gate charge density, in fact, number of charge per unit area. Okay, and let us say that in oxide region the charges could be Q naught prime, but actually as per ideal consideration of the MOS capacitor, this is considered to be zero. And then there is a semiconductor region. So in the semiconductor region, let us say that the charge density is QC, okay, prime. This is Q naught prime and this is QG prime. Prime I am using because I am talking about the charge density. Okay, charge divided by the surface area. Okay, so three different charges may be there in this, in the MOS capacitor: gate charge, oxide charge, and semiconductor charge. Okay, and the sum of these actually, QG prime plus Q prime plus QC prime, is to be equal to zero. Or you can also call it QG prime plus QC prime is equal to zero, because we are considering this Q naught prime is equal to zero. Okay, there is no oxide charge. All right, so the V is equal to V naught plus psi s. Now if there is any change in this gate terminal potential, if there is an incremental change in V, so that del V will be actually equal to del V naught plus del psi s. Okay, so if there is any change in the gate voltage, that will be balanced by the change in the oxide voltage drop in the oxide and the change in the surface potential, that is actually delta psi. So this is actually noted as a potential balance equation. Potential balance equation. Okay, if I make an incremental change here, delta V, so then that delta V part of this will actually drop in this oxide, and the part of this will drop in the semiconductor. Okay, so the part that will drop in the semiconductor is delta psi S, and the part that will drop in the oxide is actually delta V naught. Okay, similarly, the total charge is equal to zero, net charge is zero, Qj prime plus Qc prime equal to zero. So if there is any charge change in the gate charge, delta Qj prime, so that will be balanced by the semiconductor charge, which will be delta Qc prime. Okay, means if there is an increment in the gate charge and gate charge is positive, so the same amount of negative charge will generate in the semiconductor. If there is a negative change, if there is a let's say negative change in the gate charge, let's say that gate charge is negative and that is getting increased, so the semiconductor charge will be positive, and that will also increase in the same amount to balance this increment in the gate charge. Okay, all these assumptions are in line with that of a parallel plate capacitor. Okay, because we are treating so far this as a parallel plate capacitor with one plate being the metal plate, but the another plate is not as clear as this metal plate. The another plate is semiconductor plate. Okay, and the charge that will be developed in the semiconductor is being considered as a charge on the second plate of a parallel plate capacitor. Okay, so is it clear to all of you?
Sir, why phi s is taken only up to that line and not up to that ground?
Which one?
That phi
sir,
s.
This why? One.
Yes, only why up to that dash
because,
line?
Because this is neutral region, okay? What I am considering that the charge will be developed only in this region. Whether it is a positive charge or negative charge, it will be in this region only, okay?
Okay.
And this region remains neutral, so there is no potential drop. Okay. I mean, you can extend this up to this point, no problem, but it depends upon the thickness here. There may be some portion of the semiconductor that may remain neutral. Okay. So, if neutral means there is no change in the potential. Okay. Because the change in the potential, change in the charge concentration, is actually charge can be related with the potential. Okay, so if there is nothing change, nothing is changing in the neutral region, so you can't relate this with the potential. Okay, so what I'm actually considering that in this region there may be some kind of charge, maybe positive, negative, depending upon what will be applied here at the gate terminal. Okay, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we'll consider three different cases. Okay, where the gate voltage V that is applied to the gate terminal is negative, and in the second case it is equal to zero, and in the third case it will be greater than zero. Okay. So we'll see actually how the charges will be developed in the device. Okay, and what will be the other consequences of that charge development on the energy Venn diagram. Okay, so let us consider the first case where this V is less than zero. The potential V less than zero means it's a negative. The gate voltage is negative. Okay, so if the gate voltage is negative, then there will be some negative charge in the metal plate. Okay, and this is metal plate, gate voltage V is negative. Okay, this is grounded. So there will be negative charge in the metal plate and equal amount of the positive charges will be generated in the at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface in the semiconductor, okay, near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. It's a like parallel plate capacitor. In parallel plate capacitor, this terminal is connected to the negative terminal of the battery. So there is a negative charge here, and this negative charge will lead to the equal amount of the positive charge in the semiconductor. Okay, and if there is a positive charges here in the semiconductor, it means that the direction of the electric field will be like this. Field will be, and these positive charges are what? These are actually holes. Okay, because we are considering, let us say here, p-type. Until I state otherwise, you will consider that the semiconductor is p-type. Okay, so in p-type semiconductor, there are actually plenty of holes, but because of this negative potential, okay, some additional holes will be generated near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. And the hole concentration here near the surface will be much larger than the hole concentration in the bulk of the semiconductor. Okay, so there will be field lines developed like this. Okay, because the holes that were already there, those were be actually getting balanced by some other charges. As you know that in p-type semiconductor, it remains neutral. But these are the additional holes that are developed because of this potential. And therefore, the field lines will be emanating from those positive charges and will be terminated to the negative charges of the metal. Okay, and therefore, as a result, the electric field is set up and the field direction is this. Okay, from the semiconductor to metal. Okay, and if we also relate it with the potential, then you will see that the field lines, if we follow the field lines, okay. So, if we follow the field lines, then we can say that this side is relatively at higher potential than this side, okay. This side of the semiconductor, bottom side, is relatively at the higher potential than the top side, okay. And it means that the energy bands will now bend in the semiconductor. And the bending will be in which way? You saw it in the ideal MOS capacitor case. Here, the energy bands were flat. It means there were no electric field, no charges in the system. Okay, but now there is an electric field and the field direction is in this particular fashion. Okay. So, because of this field now, the bands that are present in the semiconductor, they will bend. How this bending will happen if this is the field direction?
It will bend downwards as it moves forward.
As it moves right, it will bend downward.
Sure. See, it means that if there is a field line like this, it means that if I am considering two points here, so this point will be at higher, will be at lower potential than this point. Okay, so energy here will be higher than this or lower than this. Let's say that potential here is V1 and here it is V2. Okay, so V1 is greater than V2.
Energy at V2 will be higher than at
yes.
V1.
So if the energy at V2 is higher, at this point is higher, then how the bands will bend? Energy
downward
in,
as we
energy
move
is increasing in this way. Okay, energy increasing in this way. So at V2 the energy level will be higher than the energy at V at this point. Okay. If I call it 0.2 and this 0.1, so at 0.2 energy level will be higher than the 0.1. So it means that the bands have to bend upward. Okay, agreed or not?
Yes.
that is what actually is shown here. You can see in this picture. Okay, so the EC level is bent upward. Okay, EB is also bent upward, and EI will also follow this. Okay, but EF remains constant because there is no current flow. Even under the bias condition, there is no current flow because of the oxide, thick oxide. So EF remains same at constant in the semiconductor as well as constant in the metal. Okay, but now the metal EF layer goes above the semiconductor metal layer by the amount Q time V. Okay, if the V is the applied potential, so by this V the Fermi level will split up. Okay, and the difference in the energy level will be Q time V. So that is actually shown here. The metal side Fermi level has gone up because metal side is at the negative potential than the body of the semiconductor. Body is grounded and here the potential is negative at the gate terminal. It means the energy, electronic energy goes upward. So this EF is above this EF by the amount QV, which is the corresponding energy of the voltage applied at the gate terminal, and the energy bends actually bend upward. Okay, does it make sense? Any doubt from anybody? Okay, and when the bends are bending upward, it means that the EV is coming closer to EF because EF is constant, and EV coming to closer is an indication that this EF minus EV is actually decreasing. Okay, and a smaller EF minus EV is indication of a larger hole concentration. Okay, so holes are actually, you can see that present in the large number here. Okay, at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and this concentration is above the equilibrium level. When we'll move in this direction, the hole concentration will decrease, and at this point it will be equal to the equilibrium hole concentration EPO. Okay, but at the surfaces the hole concentration will be much larger than the equilibrium concentration because of this bending upward. If we keep increasing the gate potential, if we keep increasing the magnitude of the gate potential, make it more and more negative, the bands will bend upward. There will be more bending in the band. Okay, and the hole concentration will keep on increasing at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Okay, so there is a piling up of the holes on the other plate of the capacitor. You can consider it's like this. Okay, so in this case the semiconductor charge that is actually noted as here QS. Okay, you can, if it is written to, if you want to take it in per unit area, you can keep it as a prime. Okay, so but here the absolute charge is taken. So QS is the semiconductor charge. QM in this case is considered as a metal charge. Okay, so you can see the magnitude of QM and QS are same. So mod QM will be equal to QS in this case. Okay, is it clear? So this is called the so-called accumulation region of the MOS capacitor. In MOS capacitor, when the applied voltage is negative at the gate terminal, there is a hole pileup at the silicon dioxide interface, and the MOS capacitor is considered to be in accumulation. Okay, so this condition is accumulation condition because charges are accumulated. Because the holes are accumulated at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. It was already p-type. Now the extra holes are accumulated at the interface, so we call it the accumulation region. Okay, and in this accumulation, actually the psi s, the surface potential, is also negative. Okay, the surface potential is negative. What is the surface potential? This potential, psi s. Okay. So, psi s becomes negative in this case. Means the bulk potential will be larger than the silicon-silicon dioxide interface potential. Okay, and it's also obvious because the body is at the ground level and the gate is at the negative level. So, if I move downward, actually, the body will be at the highest potential compared to the gate, and it keeps decreasing. Okay, value will be keep decreasing. It becomes more and more negative, and at the highest level when I reach to the gate terminal. Okay, so this is called the accumulation region of MOS capacitor. Is it okay? Any question, any doubt? Okay, then the second condition is when the applied potential is positive but small. Okay, if the gate potential is positive and small. So, if the gate potential is positive, then there will be positive charge developed in the metal layer. Okay, so that is actually indicated by this Qm. Okay, so if Qm is the magnitude of the total charges that are developed in the metal. Okay, and now the equal amount of the charge has to be developed in the semiconductor. Okay, so the semiconductor charge has to be negative. So, metal side positive charge. Okay, semiconductor side negative charges. Okay, so the field lines will be like this, and if the fields are from left to right, then the energy bands will bend downward. Okay, just in the reverse manner of the accumulation case. So here you can see all the energy bands except the EF are actually bent downward. Okay, and the metal side Fermi level now has gone below than the semiconductor side Fermi level by the amount QV. Okay, this is the QV. It is because now the metal is at the higher potential, semiconductor is at the lower potential side. So, metal side Fermi energy level goes down. Okay, so EF is below, the metal Fermi level is below the semiconductor Fermi level. Bends are downward. Okay, and there will be electric field in the semiconductor. There will also be charges in the semiconductor. Okay, so what will happen when the potential goes above zero? Okay, so this will the field lines. These field lines, if you follow the direction of the field lines, the in semiconductor there were holes actually, because the semiconductor is considered to be p-type. There were holes near the, holes were uniformly distributed throughout the semiconductor. But if you look at this direction of the electric field, the holes will try to move deeper into the semiconductor. Okay, because they will follow the direction of this electric field. And once the holes will follow the direction of the electric field, some portion below the silicon-silicon dioxide interface gets depleted. Okay, so and the negative acceptor ions will be uncovered, okay, in this region. So, the negative charges that are actually built up in the semiconductor are the charges of these uncovered acceptor ions, like the depletion region of p-n junction, one-sided p-n junction. Okay, so you can consider it as a one-sided p-n junction, n plus p. Okay, and when I am applying a bias voltage at n plus at n side, okay, then and I'm just making keeping the polarity of the battery so that the n plus p junction is in reverse bias. So with increasing magnitude of the battery voltage, the increasing magnitude of the reverse bias, the depletion width keeps on increasing. Okay, so it means that more and more acceptor ions will be uncovered in this depletion region. Okay, and the rate of this increment of the depletion region, the rate of increment in the charge in this depletion region will be same as the rate of increment of the charge in the metal. Okay, and therefore the total metal charge will be equal to the total semiconductor charge, and that is actually shown here. Okay, so in the semiconductor now there are negative charges, and these charges are because of the acceptor ions, okay, which are uncovered, because the holes that were in the near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, they have now moved away from the interface. Okay, so there are charges. If there is a width, the width of the depletion region is W, okay, and the charge density, the doping level of the semiconductor was Na. Okay, so QNA into W is the total charge in the depletion region. Okay, so in this case QM, the metal charge, which is positive charge, will be equal to the magnitude of this QNA into W, because this QNAW is going to be negative. So the total gate charge is total semiconductor charge, and the semiconductor charge will be actually the charge of the uncovered acceptor ions like the depletion region of the p-n junction diode. Okay. But at the same time, you see here that this the bending is in such a way that EV now near the surface is moving away from the EF. It's an indication if the EV is going away from the EF, means this EF minus EV is increasing. It's an indication of that it's an indication that the hole concentration is decreasing. Okay. But you can see that EI is still above EF, okay, the edge of EI here, this is still above the Fermi level EF, okay. So it means that the whole concentration is very less, and the only charges in the in this region is because of the acceptor ions, okay. But if I further increase the voltage V, the gate voltage V, okay, then there will be stronger field from the metal to the semiconductor side, and more bending will be seen, okay, and the bending could be even so high that the EI level will cross this EF, okay. EI will initially, the tip of this EI here will touch this EF, and then it will also cross this EF. Okay, so if EI is crossing this EF, then it's an indication of the electrons here near this interface, silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Is it or not? If EI level is lower than EF, if EF is greater than EI, okay, in n-type semiconductor, you know that EF is greater than EI. Okay, so when EI just touches this EF, the material, the semiconductor becomes intrinsic in nature. It was p-type initially, but when we applied the potential, positive potential at the gate terminal, okay, the holes start depleting, means holes concentration is decreasing near the semiconductor, semiconductor and oxide interface, and when voltage, the gate voltage is increased further, in that case the hole have been depleted in large number, and there is a chances that the hole concentration in this region is equal to the electron concentration in this region, okay. So if hole concentration is equal to the electron concentration, it means the semiconductor becomes intrinsic, okay, and hole concentration if it is np, ns at the surface is equal to np, ns at the surface equal to ps, the hole concentration at the surface is equal to ni, okay. So in that case this ei level will just touch this ef in this fashion. However, if I further increase this potential V, gate potential, then there will be more bending and EI can come below this EF. So at the moment this EI goes below this EF, it's the indication that the now the semiconductor has become n-type. Okay, because in n-type semiconductor, EI is below EF and we call that the semiconductor is under inversion. Okay, so that's why if V is greater than 0, we call it, and if V is of the moderate value, we call the semiconductor to be in the inversion. Okay, so MOS capacitor is under inversion. And in inversion condition, there will be two different kind of charges in the semiconductor. One is because of the electrons that are induced near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and below that there will be uncovered acceptor ions. So these are acceptor ions in p-type semiconductor, and at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface there is a electron, there are electrons, and the electrons will be created in a they will be in the thin sheet form. Okay, a sheet of electrons will be generated at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and below that there will be acceptor ions, and that will go deeper into the semiconductor. So in this case, the total charge, gate charge QM, will be the sum of this electronic charge plus sum of this acceptor ions. So QM will be equal to mod of QN plus QNAW. Okay, so this is called the inversion region of the MOS capacitor. Okay, understood? Any question? Is it okay to all of you? Okay, fine. So here we will stop, and then